just because you had a throat culture, or just because the doctor says, oh, that looks like strep throat. Buyer beware. It's that time of year again where people are getting sore throats and they're getting swollen tonsils, and you may in fact be told you have tonsillitis or strep throat. So today we're going to talk about tonsils. Now, I think tonsils are maybe one of my favorite subjects. What the heck are tonsils and why do we care about them? I like to draw a picture for my patients of a harbor with a fort on either side of the harbor, at the entrance to the harbor. And those fortresses at the entrance to the harbor are actually your tonsils. Your tonsils are the first bastion of your immune system, of your white blood cells, that encounter basically everything you swallow, or for that matter, breathe, into your body. So they are the first line of defense against these, and the first alert system that something potentially bad is on the way. And one of the things that impressed me early on in my new career is that a great number of my patients with autoimmune diseases, with lectin intolerance, had their tonsils removed at an early age, or at the very least were treated multiple times for tonsillitis, usually with antibiotics. So I became very impressed that on a history, whenever they said, I don't have my tonsils, I would almost always predict that we'd find some mischief in terms of what they could tolerate as foods, or that we'd probably find an autoimmune disease. And quite amazingly, that prediction almost always comes true. So what is it about the tonsils? First of all, realize that if there is a war going on at the entrance to your harbor, if there's a battle going on, that does not necessarily mean that there is a battle with bacteria. Because bacteria are in your mouth. We now know that we have a rather diverse oral microbiome. And fun fact, a huge number of the bacteria that are normal in our mouth are streptococcus. Now, I mention that because most of the streptococcus in our mouth are perfectly fine. They're supposed to be there. And they not only don't do us any harm, but they're part of our oral flora. But so many of my patients and so many doctors look at somebody's tonsils and they're red and they go, oh my gosh, you have strep throat. And some of them may even take a swab or a culture and strep grows out. And they go, yep, you have strep throat. Here's some antibiotics. Let me tell you an interesting story. When I was a medical student back in the dark ages, we at the Medical College of Georgia, we had the benefit of rotating through practitioners' offices, even in first or second year of medical school. And I rotated through a pediatrician's office. And of course, almost every kid in there was in there with a cold or a sore throat or an ear infection. And the doctor would swab the kid's throat and put it on a petri dish and set it to culture. And then the nurse would hand the mother a prescription for antibiotics and a decongestant. And after a couple of days of watching this, I said, well, yeah, you just took a throat culture. It's going to take 48 hours for that throat culture to grow out. And even then, we'll have to find out if you have the bad kind of streptococcus, beta hemolytic strep. Why did you give her antibiotics before you knew? And he kind of looked at me like, Sonny, let me explain something to you. The kid, no matter what I do, will most likely get better. But I've got to give mother something to do. And this is something for the mom to do. And I'm going, yeah, but you don't even know if he has a bacterial infection. And he kind of shrugged and he said, if I don't give her that something to do, she'll go down the block and get it from my competitor, who'll be more than happy to give it to her. So that's the way it is. Welcome to medicine. That had a really interesting effect on me. And the point of all this is, most of the things that turn your tonsils red are not beta hemolytic strep. Yes, you may culture strep when you swab somebody's tonsils, but 9 times out of 10, it is not beta hemolytic strep. In fact, beta hemolytic strep, tonsillitis, has a very interesting appearance, and I won't go into that today. So, just because you had a throat culture, or just because the doctor says, oh, that looks like strep throat, buyer beware. Finally, much of the inflammation of tonsils, in my experience, has come from people interacting with lectins or casein A1 in American milk, not from anything else. That's the problem with tonsils and tonsillitis. Now, luckily, I had a lot of tonsillitis, and I can't believe the number of times I was told I had strep throat. Looking back, I probably didn't have strep throat, or I may have had streptococcus on my tonsils, but it wasn't the bad kind. Luckily for me, my parents kind of persevered, even though the doctors wanted to take my tonsils out because they were always inflamed and always very big. But they were always inflamed and always very big because I personally am quite lectin intolerant, and the battle was ongoing there. So please, if you have kids, number one, don't start antibiotics until you actually have a culture that says beta hemolytic strep. That's the only reason you would need to take antibiotics, and it's incredibly rare. And you can find it on a culture. Okay, so as I was in medical school, still with my tonsils, I had interesting big white, for lack of a better word, pebbles that would develop in my tonsils. And they would appear on the outside of my tonsil, and occasionally, I'd kind of cough them up and spit them out, and they smelled really bad. And in medical school, I was taught that these are called tonsillitis. I'm lisping, tonsillitis, and that nobody knew what they were. When I started reading the literature of lectins and our defense system against lectins, it turns out that tonsillitis are extremely common in people who are sensitive to lectin. And if you will, they're basically the dead bodies of the soldiers of the white cells who have been fighting this battle. And to this day, I am pleased that quite a number of my patients had tonsillitis, and that remarkably, those tonsillitis disappeared when they started a lectin-free or lectin-light diet. I haven't had a tonsillitis in over 30 years because there's no more battle occurring at my tonsils. So if you have something like that, rest assured, it's just another sign that these fortresses guarding your harbor are hard at work, and you ought to get rid of the things that they're battling. Now, is there a situation where you have to remove tonsils? Yes, of course there is. Some kids get such large tonsils and adenoids, which is the corresponding tissue at the back of our nose, that they literally can't breathe properly. That's a decision between you and your practitioners. But one of the things I urge my patients who have kids with big tonsils is, first and foremost, put them on a lectin-free diet, and you'd be shocked how many of them have saved their kids' tonsils and adenoids because they're no longer battling the troublemakers. And that includes American milk products. Let me be clear about that. And it is a lectin-like substance that is one of the troublemakers in kids who have big tonsils and adenoids. And that's an easy thing to fix. Thanks so much for watching, but don't go anywhere. This next one is sure to surprise you. And that's why lectins are so mischievous. So why would a plant do this?